Hello everyone, welcome to Bridge Course. Myself Dr. Mannam Ramanjanayalu. I am from Division of Physics, Department of Science and Humanities, Vignan's Foundation for Science, Technology and Research. In this video, I will be discussing about the lasers. By the end of this video, you will be able to understand what is a laser, what are the different characteristics of laser, the process behind the laser, and various important applications in day-to-day life. Let's start with applications of laser. Lasers have a lot of applications in many different fields like medicine, materials, processing, industrial applications, communication applications, military applications, and many more. As you can see in the picture, the lasers can be used in the barcode readers. This kind of barcode readers you can even find in the local stores these days. Lasers can also be used in the color printers, color copiers, etc. Lasers can be used as a reading and writing heads, as shown in the figure. You can see this is a laser head which is focused on the CD and the DVD drive. So it can read and write the information in it. In addition to this, lasers can also be used in entertainment purposes. You can see in the picture the lasers in the laser shows. In addition to this, lasers can also be used in holography. Holography means recording of three-dimensional image. You can see in the picture that the image is a three-dimensionally recorded image using holography technique where lasers are being used. Other than these, lasers can also be used in industrial applications such as drilling, cutting, welding, etc. In this case, you can see in the picture, lasers are being used for drilling and cutting on the metal sheets. Lasers can also be used as, in the picture, lasers can be used for welding purposes. These are the industrial applications. In addition to these, lasers can be used in the medicine. As you can see in the picture, laser can be used for eye surgery. Lasers can also be used in the bloodless surgery. And also, lasers can be used to break the stones in the kidneys. Lasers can also be used in skin therapy. Many other applications are there in the medicinal field. The most important application of the laser is communication. As you can see in the picture, optical fiber communication. Optical fiber communication plays an important role in the present day life for communication as well as the data transmission. In this optical fiber communication, lasers are being used to transport the data from one place to another place without losing any energy. These are the important applications of the laser. Now, the question is, why only lasers are being used in these applications? Why not a normal light can be used? To understand this, let us try to find out what is the differences between a laser light and a normal light. After this, you will be able to understand why lasers are so special to use in different applications. In this picture, you can see this is a normal ordinary torch light and this one is a laser light. In the ordinary light, let us find out the differences between the ordinary light and the laser light. As we all know that in the ordinary light, it emits all wavelengths. In the case of laser, it emits only one particular wavelength. That means ordinary light emits all wavelengths and the laser light emits only one particular wavelength. That means laser light is a monochromatic light and normal light is a polychromatic light. And also you can see in the ordinary light, the photons which are emitting from the ordinary light travels in all the directions. And also the light is spreading like this way. Whereas in the case of laser light, the photons which are emitting from the laser source are traveling in the same direction and the spread is very less. The spreading of light is called divergence. So from the picture itself we can understand ordinary light source have a highly divergent source, whereas in the case of laser light is a highly directional source. That means the light which is emitting from the laser source is having a directional characteristic and the light which is emitting from the ordinary light source will diverge in all the directions. In addition to this, you can see in the ordinary light source, if you see the photons, the wave character, there is no phase relationship between them. That means they are incoherent waves. And in the case of laser, you can see all the waves are traveling in the same direction with a constant phase difference. So the laser light is more coherent in nature. So that means the light waves which are emitting from the laser source are in coherent nature, whereas in the case of ordinary light, the light waves which are emitting from the ordinary light waves are incoherent in nature. These are the sum of the differences which we can find, and because of these difference characteristics of the laser, they find a lot of applications. Let's discuss more detailed all these characteristics of the laser. So from this slide, we understand that lasers have a different characteristics compared to ordinary light. So let's discuss the characteristics of the laser. The first characteristics of the laser is monochromatic. Monochromatic means single wavelength. The light which is emitting from the laser source will have only one color. Means the spectral line width is of the order of 5 into 10 power minus 4 angstrom units. It's very small. So we can say that the light which is emitting from the laser source is a monochromatic in nature. Whereas in the case of ordinary light, the light which is emitting from the ordinary light is not monochromatic. If you have a monochromatic, then we can use this in various applications like a communication, spectroscopy, interferometry, holography, sensors, and etc. These are all the applications where the light source require a monochromatic. This is about a monochromatic. Simply, we can say that the single wavelength. The other important characteristics of the laser is coherence. What do you mean by coherence? If we have to say coherence, if two waves are in coherence, the two waves must be traveling in the same direction, with the same frequency, with the same wavelength, and more important, constant phase difference, or the phase difference is zero. Then we can say that those two waves are in coherence with each other. You can see in the picture, the laser light, the waves which are traveling in the laser light are in coherence with each other. That means all the crust and the trough of the waves are matching at the same position. That means they are in coherence. If the waves are in coherence, then they can have a constructive interference, as you can see in the picture, constructive interference. If the waves are constructively interfere, then the resultant wave will be a high intense wave. Means high amplitude wave. Once a high amplitude is there, we can also get high intensity from this. You can see in the case of ordinary light, the waves have no phase relationship. They are incoherent waves. These waves sometimes destructively interfere and causes intensity to decrease. That is the reason why the laser light will have a higher intensity and ordinary light will have a lower intensity. The coherence is the one property which can derive two more other characteristics of the laser. They are called directionality and intensity. The directionality property comes because of coherence, because all the waves are traveling in the same direction, which gives the directional property. And also because of the coherence and constructive interference of the coherent waves, we get high amplitude wave, high intensity. So another property, high intensity, also can be derived from the coherence property. Let's see the directionality and coherence. This is the directionality. You can see the light which is emitting from the laser source travels in the same direction with a very less divergence. If we have a highly directional photons, we can use them in different applications like alignment of objects, barcode readers, communication, radar, etc. These are all the applications where one requires a highly directional photons, not a diverging photons. This is about the directionality. This highly directional property is appearing because of coherence nature. Next one is high intensity. This high intense property is also one of the consequences of coherence nature of the laser light. You can see we can make lasers starting from milliwatts power to exawatt power. The low power lasers can be used in the medical applications, whereas the high power lasers can be used kind of industrial applications like drilling, cutting, welding, machining, these kind of applications because of high power. As you can see in the picture, there is the laser is actually cutting in different shapes, designed shapes very precisely. This is because of high power lasers. High power comes because of high intensity. So we can use this high power or low power in different applications like material processing, fusion, military applications, nonlinear optic applications, etc. In addition to this, we also have another important characteristic, that is the pulse width of the laser light. We can make extremely small pulse width of the laser light after the draw, nanoseconds to femtoseconds. What is the use of this one? This can be used in very fast phenomena. For example, if some reaction is happening, the products have a lifetime of after of nanoseconds to femtoseconds. Now, if we have a laser pulse of the order of nanoseconds to femtoseconds, we can synchronize this laser source to the reaction and can get information about the products in a such a short lifetime. This is about the characteristics. I'll summarize the characteristic. The characteristics, there are five important characteristics of the laser. One is a monochromaticity, that means single wavelength nature. Second one is coherence. Laser light will have a coherence nature. Third one is highly directional, and the fourth one is high intensity, and the fifth one is very short pulse width. These are the characteristics of the laser. Now, because of these special characteristics, the lasers finds a lot of applications in the day-to-day life. Whereas a normal light don't have these special characteristics, so we cannot use a normal light in all these applications. Now the question is, from where these special characteristics are appearing in the laser? How does the laser getting these special characteristics? Let's see about this. There are two important principles behind this. One is absorption of photons and emission of photons. In the emission of photons, we have a spontaneous emission and a stimulated emission. Let us discuss in detail all these applications. The absorption of photons. In general, in any material, initially all the atoms are in the ground state. When a photon of energy is incidenting on a material, the atoms in the ground state absorbs the energy from the photon and goes to higher energy state. That means the atoms in the ground state absorbs the energy from the photon and excites to higher energy state. This whole process is called absorption of photons. In this process, initially the atoms are in the ground state, will be excited to higher energy state. After absorption process, the atom which absorbs the photon will be in higher energy state. Now atom is in higher energy state. Now, after sufficient lifetime, the atom will be de-excited to the ground state. This process is called emission process. We know that there are two type of emissions are there. One is a spontaneous emission, another one is stimulated emission. Let us discuss about the spontaneous emission first, later stimulated emission. In the spontaneous emission, before that, please note that every energy level in the atom will have a characteristic lifetime. That means if the atom is in that particular energy level, it can stay until the lifetime. That is a characteristic lifetime. Every energy level have a characteristic lifetime. If the atom is in that level, particular level, the atom can stay until their lifetime. Once the lifetime is completed, the atom from higher energy state de-excites to ground state on its own by releasing a photon. This process is called spontaneous emission. In the spontaneous emission, the photon can emit in any direction. Photon can emit randomly in any direction. There is no restriction. Let us see in the stimulated emission. In the case of stimulated emission, the photon will be forced to de-excite from higher energy state to ground state by using another photon before their lifetime. This is called stimulated emission. Here, we incident another photon with energy h nu, which is equal to the energy difference between the higher energy level and the lower energy level. This photon stimulates the atom in the higher energy state and brings back to ground state before completing their lifetime. This process is called stimulated emission. In this process, two photons will be emitted. The first one is the photon which is incident to stimulate the atom to de-excite. And the another one is when an atom is de-excited from higher energy level to ground state, which emits a photon. And here the important thing is the emitted photon follows the incident photon. That means the two photons will travel in the same direction, which are having same frequency and same wavelength, and moreover the phase difference between them is constant, that is zero. That means in the stimulated emission, two photons will be emitted and both are in coherence with each other. By this time you might be able to understand which emission is required for a lasing action. Obviously stimulated emission. In the stimulated emission, the direction of the photons can be determined by using incident photon, and also the emitted photons have a coherence nature. Whereas in the case of spontaneous emission, the photons which are emitting from the spontaneously can have a random direction, so we cannot control them. That's the case for the normal light. For this lasing light, the photons should travel in a particular direction that can be decided by the incident photon direction. This is about the stimulated emission. Now, in this present case, we only have one atom, so we are getting two photons in coherence nature. But with the two photons, we can't get a light. That means we need to have more number of photons to be in higher energy state. So that means there should be more population of atoms in the higher energy state. So that means we need to have a population inversion in the higher energy state to get a lasing action. Population inversion means it is a state of the system where more number of atoms are in the higher energy state compared to ground state. As you keep incident the more photons, more atoms in the ground state absorbs the energy and goes to higher energy state. At some point of time, we can find that the more number of atoms are in the higher energy state compared to ground state. This state refers to a population inversion. Now, we know that the more number of atoms are in the higher energy state. Now, when we incident a stimulated photons, we can de-excite all the atoms to ground state at a time so that we can get a large number of photons in coherence nature. That is what we require. In this way, we can get a lasing action. That means the conditions good to get the lasing action is to population inversion. Once these kind of waves are there, these light waves, we need to amplify to get a high intense laser. So after amplification, we get a laser. So now if you see the laser acronym, light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. That means the radiation which is emitted by the stimulated emission process being amplified. That means the radiation which is emitting from the stimulated emission has to be amplified to get a laser. So the laser is not a term, it's a process which gives you a complete information how laser is working. This is about the laser. In summarizing this class, we understand that the laser light has a special characteristics. They are highly monochromatic, highly coherence, highly directional, highly intense, and a very short pulse width. Stimulated emission is the one that actually gives you a coherent light waves which will be useful for the lasing action, followed by a population inversion. Thank you.